I'm J.R. Church. Welcome to today's webcast. It's Friday, March 26th. Gary Stearman is with me, and we've got a lot to talk about. Benjamin Netanyahu went to the White House for meetings with President Obama to try to solve the problems that were created in Israel back a week or so ago. And with all of the negotiations or the apologies or whatever it was, our president was not willing to listen to him. Gary Stearman is here with a story.
Well, J.R., the United States has set about to embarrass Benjamin Netanyahu's government. You can't put it any other way. I'm reading here from Israel National News. President Barack Obama appeared to carry on a policy of intentionally humiliating Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu this week by ignoring custom and abstaining from any public appearance with him during Netanyahu's visit to the White House, end quote. And that included a state dinner, which had already been planned. The table was set. It's customary, JR, when heads of state visit, to have a formal dinner. We understand that President Obama said, good evening, you guys talk it over. I'm going to go do some things that I have to do. And Netanyahu was not invited to dinner.
So the president ate dinner in private.
Yes.
That's appalling that our president would do such a thing to anybody. Anyone who's invited to the White House, they should have at least the courtesy to treat them humanely, treat them like human beings, fellow human beings. According to the news report I have called Times Online, for a head of government to visit the White House and not pose for photographers is rare. For a key ally to be left to his own devices while the president withdraws to have dinner in private was, until this week, unheard of. Yet, that is how Benjamin Netanyahu was treated by President Obama on Tuesday night, according to Israeli reports on a trip viewed in Jerusalem as a humiliation. Well, I want everybody in Israel to know that you are not humiliated to the people of America. It is our president who should be humiliated. For he did not treat the Israeli prime minister with decorum. It says that one congressman said it was awful. One Israeli newspaper called the meeting a hazing in stages, poisoned by such mistrust that the Israeli delegation eventually left rather than risk being eavesdropped on a White House telephone line. Another said that Prime Minister had received the treatment reserved for the president of Equatorial Ghana. Left to talk among themselves, Mr. Netanyahu and his aides retreated to the Roosevelt Room. He spent another half hour with Mr. Obama and extended his stay for a day of emergency talks to try to restart the peace negotiations. However, he left last night with no official statement from either side. He returned to Israel yesterday, isolated, after what Israeli media have called the White House ambush, for which he is largely. You know, Gary, the White House did ambush him. They knew what they were doing.
Oh, yes.
They wanted to humiliate Israel. And this, to me, this is unconscionable. Our government, ever since Truman was the very first president of all the nations of all the world, to recognize the sovereignty of the state of Israel in 1948. Our government has stood beside Israel. And yet, in recent days, having negotiated the sale of military equipment and bunker-busting bombs, they have been rerouted to some island in the, I guess, the Indian Ocean. And the F-16 parts and what have you for maintenance was capped, and now Israel has no backup for their military from the United States.
Well, just to add to what you're saying, JR, the recent event in the White House was adding insult to injury, because an organization in Israel called the Jewish Institute for National Security Affairs wrote this in a recent report. The White House has so far blocked key weapons projects and upgrades for Israel, rejecting requests for AH-64D Apache longbow helicopters while approving advanced F-16 multi-role fighters to Egypt. Israel has meanwhile refrained from objecting to American plans to sell those F-16s, plus Harpoon Block 2 anti-ship missiles, Hellfire air-to-ground missiles, fast attack craft and helicopters to the Egyptians. What's going on here is that while we are removing spares, new parts, the ability to, for the Israeli government to keep those war machines running, we are at the same time building up Egypt. This is amazing to me.
So we're financing Egypt's military buildup, whereas the Russians used to do that.
That's correct.
That's incredible. I want you to know that we are there. We are right on the edge of the battles that will lead to the tribulation period. I'm convinced of that, Gary. I'm not trying to set a date. Don't misunderstand me. But, hey, I got eyes. I got ears. I can understand. I read. I see the news. Yeah. It's moving in that direction. We have a Muslim in the White House, and I don't think there's any doubt about that, even though he covered it up. You know, Castro refused to admit he was a communist when he was trying to overthrow Batista, and our government helped him do it. And then we find out that he's a communist. I think one of these days we'll find out the true colors of those in charge in Washington, D.C., and the American people put him there. What can I say? Hey, you think there's going to be a revival in America? I hope so. I pray so. But you know what? If the rapture comes, you know, that's that little thing the Bible predicts will come. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, the voice of the archangel, the trump of God. The dead in Christ shall rise first, and we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together in them with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. If and when that comes, if it comes soon, the Republicans won't have a vote. At least 24% of the Republican Party are Christians, dedicated Christians. There was a poll out this week, Gary, that said 24% of the Republican Party felt that Obama was the Antichrist. Where'd they get that idea? You know, unless they go to church on Sunday, unless they are evangelical Christians.
Well, let me just say that America gets its stability from its Christian population. Absolutely no doubt about that whatsoever. And Israel gets its stability from American support. Always has been the case. We're withdrawing that support, JR. It's a sad day.
It is. And even though Americans across our great land can pray for the peace of Jerusalem and pray for the security of Israel, we don't have the money that the government has. We don't have the military. We can't fund them. We can't stand. You know, all we can do is pray.
Yeah.
But of course, God's on the winning side. You understand? God's on Israel's side, and Israel's going to win. So pray, because that's more powerful than money or military, isn't it?
Amen.
Our website is up. It may not be complete, but at least you're able to see us on the website, prophecyinthenews.com. And I hope you will keep coming back. We've been down for a week, or nearly a week, and we're thankful to be able to be back up again and be able to reach out to those of you who follow our ministry and watch us every day on our webcast. We don't have our weekly broadcast up yet, but it'll be coming along in a few days. We just had to get this website back up, okay? It's been down too long, and even though it's not finished, still under construction, at least you're able to see our daily webcast. So I'm J.R. Church with Gary Stearman. Have a great weekend. We'll see you again Monday with our analysis of the news.